that I fail, that I'll never make it out, yeah. Please tell me all the bad, never good, fill my head full of every single doubt.
Hey Lucas, we are almost there. I know the course on special relativity theory did not work for you. But as your academic counselor, I am sure that numerical methods and the history of mathematics will be perfect for you.
Yes, ma'am. I have photos of Newton and Descartes on the front cover of my notebooks. I just have to express out loud my admiration for them and their creations, and will easily pass all the exams.
Well, Lucas, now that I look at all the posters around here, I realize they might look a bit pretentious and intimidating, but don't be afraid.
Yes, ma'am, just a bit pretentious. Don't worry, I will ask just a pair of questions, and I am sure I will learn a lot. Oh, I'm late again. I must enter the class right now. Bye, ma'am, and thanks a lot.
Please tell me that I can't, that I won't,
hey,
that I fail, that
the
I'll
new student
out,
is
yeah.
coming late. No problem, at Random Chaos University, we all are so infernal. Oh, sorry. I meant informal, not infernal. As I was saying, in ancient times in India, China, Persia, and the Arab world, mathematicians developed methods for approximating square roots. With the help of geometry, and trial and error checkings. The ancient Greeks tried to find general natural arithmetical methods for roots of any index that were not based on geometry and did not require any trial and error checkings. But they failed to do so. In summary, mathematicians had to wait until the 17th century with the invention of the logarithm's artifice to approximate higher degree roots more practically. And of course, also the formulation of Newton's derivatives and the infinitesimal calculus in that century. So the ancient Greek attempts to use arithmetic for approximating roots were just an obstacle to reaching the supreme perfection of infinitesimal calculus that Western culture finally achieved. The magnificent work of Newton corresponds to a superior mind and a matchless culture. A wonder before which we must bow our heads and bring it our unconditional admiration. Newton created true science, he created the natural order by himself, and surpassed the terrible hindrance of arithmetic.
What? No way. So sorry, I mean, can I comment? I do not see the history of numerical methods and mathematics the way you say. But as I will show now on the blackboard using my smartphone, our current way of thinking, as imposed on us by the elite and its educational system, could cloud our judgment, disguising the big picture, and preventing us from noticing the probable existence of other ways in mathematics, rather than the infinitesimal calculus and Cartesian system. For more than 3,000 years, mathematicians found methods primarily for square roots, all relying on geometry and trial and error tests. Moreover, the algorithms were impractical and cumbersome when trying to extend them to higher degree roots. Indeed, there is no evidence of any ancient numerical approximation to cube roots, even in the case of the Greek method of conics, the duplication of the cube, and the mechanical proposal of the mesolabium. Something similar occurred in China, India, and the Arab and Persian world. The fundamentals of their square root methods were always trial and error tests, and the geometry of what is known as the binomial theorem and the coefficients of Pascal's triangle. The oldest Chinese texts about cube root extraction only showed trivial perfect cube solutions. And the algorithm was cumbersome and required trial and error tests at each step. And the method they later used for solving equations, now known as Horner's, is also a crude trial and error algorithm. Surprisingly, I recently found various arithmetical methods for approximating roots of any degree at any desired convergence rate on a website. Far more straightforward than using infinitesimal calculus. They are based on what the author calls the Fifth Arithmetical Operation and do not require derivatives, geometry, decimal fractions, or any trial and error tests, but just the simplest arithmetic. And based on their simplicity, I do not understand why those methods do not appear in the math literature. So, my vision on this is different from yours.
Please, student, do not talk nonsense. Many people write trash all over the internet. So, shut up.
The author used a generalization of a straightforward operation called the mediant, which operates by adding the numerators and denominators of any two reduced fractions. And its result is a mean value between them.
Do you mean that he can approximate roots at any convergence rate by using such a naive operation? My gosh. Please, student, who do you think you are? By the way, what is your name?
My name is Lucas. Lucas Bond.
Hey. Lucas Bond. Do you mean that you find me funny? Funny? How? I mean, do you think my face looks funny or what?
No, professor, please. He didn't mean that.
No, he is a big boy. He can explain that to me. I need to know. Funny? How?
Fine. That reminds me of the Goodfellas movie. So funny, indeed. Whatever, retaking the subject. Mathematicians used this operation very little in the history of mathematics, and commonly treated it as a curiosity. Even worse, when learning to add fractions in primary school, we were always taught that this operation was an error. I mean, the old issue of the freshman sum. The author widely generalized this operation and expanded its scope, and he considers it as the missed link in mathematics.
Well, if that operation looks like an error, it must be an error. And if only very few people used it, it must be trash. I mean, that's silly. We are talking about superior minds, you know what I mean. Please, locate yourself in life.
Well, that is not what the American philosopher Charles Sanders Peirce said when he showed up the Brocot sequences to demonstrate the numerable order of rational numbers and commented on this operation. I am quoting him on the blackboard. The basic concept is as follows. In the case of the cube root of a number p, starts with a set of three fractions whose product is p. Then, apply the fifth arithmetical operation, or say, the rational mean, for all the combinations of two fractions in the set, as shown on the blackboard. Notice that the product of each new set of fractions is trivial and equal to p. The numerators and denominators cancel each other. The natural order and simplicity imprinted in the process bring special significance to this arithmetical concept. The author consulted with many experts in the history of mathematics and numerical methods, and despite its simplicity, he could not find any precedents for this new roots approximating concept. He also noticed that the particular case shown on the blackboard is ruled by linear homogeneous recurrence relations, similar to those of a method from Daniel Bernoulli, who curiously never explained the origin of his method. So, the author worked with other initial sets of fractions and many different ways of applying this operation. But the case that surprised me the most was the arithmonic version. The arithmonic mean is a particular case of the fifth arithmetical operation, or the rational mean. And it goes this way. Given a set of three fractions, you modify their form, not their values, by making the first two numerators equal, and then doing the same with the next two denominators. If more fractions were in the set, you could continue alternating with the next numerators and denominators. So in this case, the set becomes this. Once we finished getting the fractions chained, then we add up the numerators and denominators. I mean, we calculate the rational mean of the set. The author calls this result the arithmonic mean of the set, which corresponds to a particular matching pattern or chain of numerators and denominators. Now, let's see how to use the arithmonic mean for approximating cube roots. If we use a different initial set of three fractions, whose product is p, that is, a set of three approximations by defect and excess to the cube root of a number p, and compute three different arithmonic means, as shown on the blackboard, then we get this. Three new expressions, whose product is also trivial and equal to p, notice the trivial cancellation of the numerators and denominators. The first expression is the same iteration function that results from applying Newton's method for computing the cube root of a number p, which converges quadratically and implies using derivatives. The second is a new one that converges quadratically and could be interpreted as the counterpart of Newton's method. The third is the same that results from applying Householder's method or Halley's and has cubic convergence and implies second-order derivatives. Notice that Householder's method is an extension of Newton's method that uses higher-order derivatives and correspondingly produces convergence rates of any desired order. And by repeating the process, using the later functions, according to an invariable path, then you will get this. These expressions can be used as independent iterated functions to approximate the cube root of a number p. For example, entering a guess value that we arbitrarily call xn-1 and producing a new approximation called xn and repeating that step, always making the new guess equal to the last result. Now, back to the table. In the second column, all the expressions correspond to the well-known Householder's method.
Stop. That cannot be that simple. It must be a fake. No way, it's a scam.
The first and third columns show new functions, also with convergence rates similar to those produced by infinitesimal calculus, or even better in many cases. For example, if we iterate the expressions in the fourth row, in the screen we can see the error with respect to the actual value of the cube root of 2. In the first two columns, the convergence is quartic. That is, the number of exact decimal places is multiplied by 4 in each step. We already know that the second function is equal to the Householder method of infinitesimal calculus. The error of the third expression on the right is much smaller than those of the other two. Now, it is impossible not to be surprised by all this, because we are observing convergence speeds similar to and even better than those of infinitesimal calculus. Without the need to construct the Cartesian system or the complicated Newton's derivatives concept, but just the simplest arithmetic, notice that you will see equally impressive results if you iterate any other expression in the table. So, the author is quite right in refusing to publish this method and the table in any of the current math journals devoted to framing all new ideas within their universe of chaos and relativity. Indeed, these methods certainly do not deserve such shameful and wrong treatment. Moreover, any modern math journal will try to censure the truth that the author has to say about the whole story of mathematics and the chaos and relativity theories. So, no way. These methods are for we the people, not for the relativity journals. The people that always denied the true scope of arithmetic and the existence of natural order would never address these methods with the natural orientation it should, but with their odd image of the universe that they pretend to impose to manipulate and exploit people. On the contrary, these methods show that there can be a very different way for mathematics and science, rather than those we have inherited by force.
That cannot be that simple. You need derivatives to achieve high-order convergence rates. It cannot be. Just by adding numbers, no way. It must be a fake.
Okay, Professor, please explain where I am wrong.
Ah, you just shut up. This is not about right or wrong, little poor kid. Those methods you are describing cannot exist, because superior minds from past times would have already found them. You should beware of how presumptuous you look. It would be best if you accepted that people like Newton are truly superior people. You must learn there is no God, no creator. We create the laws. There is only chaos, and superior scientists are your only guide in the dark. They put you on the road to survive and go ahead. I find your description of those alleged high-order methods and your suggestion on the existence of another general scheme of quantity. So pretentious, arrogant, and disrespectful to mathematicians from past times, to this class, and to science. You should not dare to talk that way on something that superior minds worked on over and over more than 3,000 years ago. That's atrocious.
Okay. So, I am pretentious and arrogant. I just can see that you cannot show anything wrong with those methods. And now I realize that all this unveils some interesting things. Indeed. This is not just about a bunch of new methods. It passed more than 3,000 years without any of these extremely simple high-order arithmetical methods appearing in any math text. And they could have been easily extended to the general algebraic equation and complex numbers. So, arithmetic seems to have not been the obstacle that you say. Now, I wonder all that we could have missed. The elite implemented massive propaganda to convince us that the current academic stuff is the paradigm of free thought, and they want us only focused on it. However, it is quite the opposite. They just want us to bow our heads, praise, and revere their supposed superior culture. And they needed chaos and relativistic ideas to manipulate, control, and prone people. This is the 21st century slavery.
Students, shut up, or we will be forced to take disciplinary actions against you. Please leave this room now.
Okay, that's it. I'll just put this quote on the blackboard and quietly leave.
Hey, look at that horrible quote. This is an outrage against free thought. I feel sick. I am not feeling well. Someone, please, give me my pill.
Hi Lucas. How was the course on new numerical methods?
Hi Susie. Nothing new. The professor was not interested in asking any questions. The issue is not the course, but the entire academic system. Do you remember the website you mentioned last time? There I found some new pretty simple high-order arithmetical methods that could have been used since Sumerian times because of their simplicity. However, some people seem more interested in using the whole story of mathematics as a tool to try to manipulate and control other people, as well as perpetuating old schemes.
Okay, don't worry. You can fight for things to change in our societies. Of course, I remember the website and also the new ideology, which could be the solution to the resounding failure of the current educational system and all the inherited ideologies. A new way that differs from the old failed doctrines, socialism and capitalism. Very interesting, indeed. Yes, we must fight for a truly profound socialism.
Oh!